What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Third Person Podcast. My name is Chris, and with me, as always, are my buddies Mike and Jesse.
How is it going?
What's up?
I thought you said hello. You said how.
How's it going,
guys? What's going on? We are here. We've done it. We're at the end of the season for The Walking Dead, season 7, episode 16, entitled "The First Day of the Rest of Your Life." This is our final discussion for this year for The Walking. Well, no, not for this year, but for this season, because it'll start
6 months, 7 months.
Yeah, right? It'll be October, November of 2017. It'll come back. So, not for the year, but for this season. So, what a ride it's been. It's been an amazing ride. The three of us have really enjoyed the season, even though it seemed like we didn't at sometimes. Yeah. But we've enjoyed talking about this. And this is our last discussion. It's kind of sad. It's our last one for The Walking Dead for a little bit. But then again, we got another Walking Dead in June. So, with that, why don't we go right ahead and talk about, let's just get this the synopsis out of the way. Mike, what do you got going on? What does it say?
For the synopsis, for the finale, it says, having been brutally overpowered by Negan and his saviors, Rick and the group kneel helplessly as they suffer a heavy loss that will haunt them forever.
Some bitches.
Ooh, hoo, ha, 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 ha. Haunt them forever.
Some bitches.
Does that mean Sasha's going to come back as a ghost?
Yeah. Like, oh, maybe.
The whole sheet with the eyes cut out.
Oh, how tacky.
Boo!
How 1980s.
I expect that from Abraham.
There's so much like Beetlejuice. Remember Beetlejuice?
Yeah, I love Beetlejuice.
All right, so let's start this off with the lady that we see right from the beginning.
Oh, my God. Sasha. We were all like, we were just like, no. Because the first thing they show you is her like going and like the thing falling out of her ear. And it was like, oh, my fucking God.
Yep.
So.
And then we get a series of, you know, flashbacks from there. We get her interaction with Negan. So what do you guys think about that? Let's start with her interacting with Negan. Jesse, you had a lot to say about that.
So the main thing between her and Negan that I took away was this one line.
Mm.
And it's, you got me wrapped around your finger. It's not a man-woman thing. If you had a dick, I'd still have these feelings.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I love it. Negan is letting Sasha dictate the terms. And it was the perfect like cap to that scene. He comes out with the pancakes with a smiley face and it being a douche. Yeah. And then he bends the knee.
It was her final meal, right? In the end.
Yeah, but even though he didn't know it.
And she knew her, you know, she had made a choice. You know, from the moment she stepped on the back of the flatbed where she saw the coffin, and he was even questioning, you know, you're gonna be comfortable in there. You know, what do you need? Blah blah blah. And she's like, all I need is water. And then from there, we're like, oh my God. All right,
well, you know what? I want to cut you there for a second because I don't want to leave this section yet. Before we leave that part section, when they're on the flatbed, you know, that's actually one of my favorite flashback scenes because he walks up there and he's like, look, I know this is fucked up and I know this is fucking hard. And he's basically saying, I don't remember the exact words. He's like, but you know, I appreciate that you're doing this, you know, it was like a genuine, and we got to see now, I know Jeffrey Dean Morgan from Supernatural. All right.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you guys watched that show, but he played the boy's dad on that show and he was fucking awesome. And I like fell in love with that man then. Like, of course, he's been in other shit before and after that. But, you know, so you really got to see, because this is kind of besides playing the comedian, right, in Watchmen, this is the side, this is like a character that I don't think we've really seen him play.
They gave you a human side of him.
And I want to say,
right, for a split second.
And I really enjoyed that. I really enjoyed because knowing what we know about his past now through the comic, right? It's like I just really enjoyed that. It really was like, you did that good. You did that real good. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to mention that because that's definitely a great scene. That little quick scene on the flatbed. So before we left that section, I wanted to talk about it. So go ahead, Jesse.
Yeah.
I don't think I'll say anything. I think it was Mike.
Oh no! I thought you started to talk.
No, I was just saying again that she was at peace and she made her choice. As soon as she asked Negan for that water bottle, I mean,
yeah, hell yeah,
it was over. You know, she wasn't going to. And she said in the cell when they were negotiating the terms, when Negan said, "I'm going to take three," she said one, and she said one like I'm gonna be the one.
Yeah, well, I think we all thought that.
And in the end, you know, we see that she was.
Yeah.
You know, so it was a lot of foreshadowing of what was to come in the end after, you know, by the end of the episode. And it's bittersweet because even though she wasn't one of my favorite characters, and I don't think she was one of your, you know, yours between you
touch
two.
And go.
Yeah, it was because they take, you know, you have your top echelon of characters, you know, your Ricks. Yeah. You know, your Michonne's, your Maggie's, your
Daryl. You got your primo characters, and then your secondary, and your tertiary. Exactly. Right, yeah.
And wherever she was, that
she was definitely secondary. She was secondary.
Exactly.
She, yeah.
So, it, you know, in the end, it was bittersweet. It was nice the way they gave her somewhat of like a great way of going out on the show. And I think a lot of the actors that leave the show, they all say, As soon as I see that I'm gone in this show, when I read this script, my final script, I just want to make sure it's going out in a way that, number one, that character should go out.
Right.
You know, if it's an Abraham, go out saying, suck my dick. You know what I mean? Go, you know, some of these other characters, you know, just going out the way that particular character should. And she was selfless, and she made her choice, you know? So I thought it was nice. It was a nice homage to her and her span. She's been on the show for what, 4 seasons? Yeah. You know, she was around
in season three.
Yeah.
So it was good to see that part for me, for Sasha, and I thought they did a good job giving her the respect of the kind of character she kind of grew into. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
You know what I liked? I liked how they gave us the story. It was a situation where you already knew the end. You knew the end from the beginning, from the first moment. And then they let the next hour and a half go. And even though you knew where it was going to go, it was still like, oh, man. You know, like you still felt.
Yep.
Hers a Walker. Hers a Walker was fucking cool, though. I mean, we touched on it a little bit, but that was just really, really cool. She got to eat someone's face, which was good. Can we talk about her second death? When... I almost called him by his real name, but when Jesus and Maggie are walking in the forest, then they're all out kind of looking for her, and they find her, and he basically tackles her to the ground, and Maggie takes literally 5 minutes to fucking kill her.
We all
realize, we're like, wait, what the hell? He's still holding her. Like, what the hell, man? Like, she's a freshly made walker, so she's like still got the strength and muscle tone in there, you know? And he's
It was a build up to make the scene that much more emotional for us, the viewer. And
I didn't know she was going to kill him. I thought he had already killed her. Like, I thought they just weren't going to show it. I was like, oh, and she's watching it. Okay. Yeah. And then all of a sudden she was going to do it. I'm like, oh shit. All right.
It didn't make much sense, but it was really well done. Yeah.
So
she's with the ones. She's with her Abraham. She's with her Bob. She's with her Tyrese. She's
with her brother, yeah.
Speaking of Abraham, what'd you guys think of the flashbacks?
Oh, it was great. Talk about homage. It was so great to have him back there. And like Jesse, you mentioned it more than once in these videos that it's like, you know, him and his comments and his overall. You know, she had a premonition. She had a premonition of what was going to happen. She knew something was going to happen, you know?
That's what I was excited to see. We got a glimpse before they went out to try to get Maggie to the hilltop. We never, you know, obviously we didn't see this. So we're seeing this interaction between the two of them, between Abraham and Sasha. And we see that after, the conversation was over. Abraham was like, listen, you had said something. Let Maggie deal with this on her own. I forgot exactly what he said.
She said, let Maggie take care of Maggie.
And he was like, listen, you don't believe that. You know?
Yeah, you're just saying that to be a hard ass, and you just don't want us to do it. And
still want us to do it, but who knows what would have happened if they weren't there. You know what I mean? If they weren't in the original lineup. So yeah, that was great. It was cool to see Cutlets come back for a little bit.
Oh, it was great. You know? It was great to have him back. I'm sure he was.
We got a couple of great lines out of him too. Yeah. I mean, we got sandblasting your nutsack every step to the car.
Yeah, that was good.
And when our big meaties are on the chopping block to save someone else's, I mean, it's classic Abraham.
Yeah. It was just, again, it was just great to see him. It was great to have that, those pieces in there, you know?
Yeah.
Going back to that.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Go ahead real quick. I'll go back to that in a minute.
I was going to say, you know, and it made it more poignant, the fact that they, like, that really pulled on the heartstrings, you know, getting to see him again with her and really pulling that into your psyche.
And on an emotional level.
Yeah.
With the kissing, and we didn't, we never really got, it was like Abraham was with Rosita.
Yeah. They had that one episode where they were trapped for a little while, for like a day or so. And then after that, they were together.
You know? We saw how they gave us how much love they really felt for each other.
Yeah.
We did
get a couple other scenes too, when he was like, "Let's make a baby" and stuff, and
a couple of things. But I mean, it was an end of a chapter, you know, for her, number one. But we saw the connection between them, you know, that they really, you know, that they really legitimately cared for each other.
Absolutely.
Because I know a lot of people bitching about that, how, you just leave, you just left Rosita, and within however much time passed, you're with this chick, and it legitimately seemed like they cared, you know?
Yeah. Going back to that, let Maggie take care of Maggie, I feel that that was a really well-done scene, but not just because of that, because of what he said after, when he was talking about deep down, it's going to eat at you, and it's going to be the one thing that's going to stick with you forever. And it's just, you expect Cutlass to be, you know, the goofy but lovable character due to his "Who's Deanna?" and all that kind of stuff, but he's actually a real deep character.
Yeah,
she was like his comic character.
You know, he knew her. He says, I know you. Yeah. So going back to your point before, Mike, is that it showed how much they loved each other. When you care for someone in real life, IRL, when you care for someone, you pay attention to every little thing. Like, that's what happens. That's what you do. And it showed, that was great writing on their part, because it showed, like, this person was so focused on this person that he knew all her idiosyncrasies, all her little things, all what she really means when she says something. So, yeah, you're right, man. That was just... Yeah. Again, those, it just made those scenes all the more powerful, you know?
Yeah, good way to go. I mean, a good way to go. Respectful thing from the writers to give her that much. And
I loved the scenes in the coffin, but I kept expecting Al Green's "Let's Stay Together" every time I heard the music. I kept expecting to hear it. I don't know why. I guess it's because that Motown, I don't know.
It had something going on, yeah.
Yeah, but I enjoyed, like, how, even through the music, though, Sasha was saying Cullis's lines, and then it cut straight to the flashback.
To them.
Her lines. Yeah, exactly. It was a great way to do that. I enjoyed that.
Really well done.
Yeah.
I think we're done with Sasha, though.
All right, let's move on from Sasha.
Hey, we gave her a little extra because
she was a big part, though, show, you know? And she, deserved it, you know? Where you guys want to go? You want to hit,
the Working Company?
Okay, let's head over
to... Or you want to go Morgan?
No, let's get to Morgan. Let's do that, because that's really quick. We basically saw the cool thing about that whole scene as they're walking past the point where Richard had set up that whole shopping cart thing. They get there again and there's more shopping carts there, and they're like, "But he's dead," like, you know. I thought that was kind of cool. Couldn't it be him. It turns out it was Morgan, and they were saying, he's like, she was mad at Morgan, Carol. She's like, "What, are you killing them? Are you starting this too early? What are you doing?" He's like, "No, it's just walkers." But, you know, and then Mike got pissed off because he's being kind of wishy-washy, right? And we've beat that to death. You and I are so critical of him and of Morgan and Carol. Jesse is a little more, gives them a little more credit, but, you know,
they're just so badass. That's why they're such pivotal.
Yeah, you
want
to stop them seeing.
War.
Yeah, it's like, get over yourselves, get over your shit. You live in a fucking world with zombies. Just fucking deal with it. Enough. Stop it.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we get that, and we get a really cool speech, you know, from the king, which is fucking cool. You know.
Actually, have that memorized by now.
Yeah, he snaps him out of it. Yeah. You know, he snaps Morgan out of it.
Right.
You know, Morgan brought up the fact about the riot gear, you know, that it was
Benjamin's.
It was Benjamin's.
Well, Ezekiel did. Ezekiel says you're wearing.
Yeah.
I see you're wearing his gear. Is that to honor him or.
For your own.
Right.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that's what made him, you know, go. And then obviously we see him joining along with them, which was a cool scene. Number one, before they even came up to Morgan, before they were just as they were approaching the shopping cart, you see Carol, and what is she doing? She's leading these guys. She's taking lead
again. Yeah.
She has her AK-47 up or whatever, and who's right next to her or right behind her there a little bit was fucking
Jerry.
Ezekiel and Shiva. Yeah. And Shiva. So yeah, we see that. There was a continued pattern in this. We saw, besides the memorial of Sasha and her leaving the show, we saw the step ups of so many new leaders now. You know what I mean? Maggie, you know, we see you know, Carol back in her role. You know, hopefully her and Morgan are back to being fucking badass Carol and Morgan.
Right.
But it's just great to see. I don't want to see Carol cooking something or gardening in that house by herself. You know what I mean? I want her holding a fucking weapon ready to pop somebody's fucking top. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
definitely,
it's just great to see, because we see, you know we're seeing everybody say, this is it. Let's go for it. And now they're heading on, you know, yeah, to Alexandria. You know what I mean? So that was a build up to the end. You know, it was a build up to this Negan coming to Alexandria.
Big time. Something I noticed, and this scene here really struck it with me, the actors during the season finale, they ramped their emotion. They went from 100 to 1,000 in the span of one episode.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Carrie Payton's, "Do you seek to extinguish everything of who you were?" And then Morgan's like, "Nah, I don't seek it. I'm just stuck."
Yeah.
And then Ezekiel's just like, "Do you want the saviors dead? Then cease this folly and join my brigade."
Yeah.
So it's really good acting, really strong delivery. And then Carrie Payton, Ezekiel, he says, "You are not stuck." And it's powerful.
Yeah.
The guy has... It strikes. It's right there. It's in your chest. It's a fist, mm-hmm, right there. Yeah. And powerful acting, powerful words. The man's got the range. So does Morgan.
Hey.
You know, it's really great that they took... That they're doing this. Like, I mean, I don't know about anyone else that doesn't like read the comic, but the three of us read the comic. We're well-versed in it. We're well-versed in those characters. We're well-versed in who these characters are on the TV show, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like... Sometimes I wish I could see the show from an outsider's point of view, of just somebody who's like, "Oh, hey, that zombie show's on. Let's watch the zombie show." You know what I mean? Like,
that myself.
Well, you know what I'm saying? Because it's like these characters. Of course, that's what Ezekiel would be like, and of course, and not only, like you said, they've gotten the best actors to play these fucking roles. Like, they're spot on. And I don't know why, because you're saying all this stuff, and I'm like, damn, like it's just. I wonder what people think. Like, are people like, "That's so weird and random that this guy's talking like that"? Meanwhile, we're like, "Yeah!" You know, like...
Well, that's... Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, because knowing so much of the comic and...
Like, that's the comic character right there.
Using
those so characters much as the... And they didn't make them comic more real, or, you know, dumb them down. It's,
yeah,
you know?
Even Shiva, you know, we'll get into her later, but just how she goes at, she knows who to go after.
Yeah,
you know
yeah
what I mean. It's just funny because, you know, it's, there's like some jokes going around saying, "Oh, even in the zombie apocalypse, people can train a tiger to know exactly who to go after and who the
right,
enemy
yeah,
is." You know
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's comical in that way. They're following the comic relatively to a T on some of these major, major plot lines.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But before we move on to, so we see obviously the kingdom now, and Carol and Morgan on their way to Alexandria at the hilltop. Let's go to the hilltop with Maggie, and the fact that we see Judith was there.
Yeah, that's a big thing.
Obviously, for a precaution. And we see Enid there also taking care of Judith when Maggie and Jesus were talking. And who was missing? You know, it was Gregory.
Gregory, yeah.
So like I said before, with the lead ups and now people taking the initiative to step up and being the leader of some particular groups. Obviously, Maggie, she kind of has been, even before Gregory now stepped out. But Greg, you know, Maggie gets her troops together. You know, she says, "This is what we're gonna do. Whoever, you know, we're gonna fight and we're gonna head on, you know, on our way to Alexandria too." So, you know, we're seeing. And throughout the season, we've seen where everybody was supposed to be and the different places. We've seen Maggie strictly at the hilltop. We've seen, you know, Rick and the Alexandrians, you know, going from here to there, going Oceanside, collecting. And this is just awesome to me because now it's every – it was a unit now. You know what I mean? It didn't seem, especially not going too forward before we talk about it, but after we see – the battle that ensues between Negan and the group, we've seen them as a complete unit. You didn't necessarily see everybody as these are the hilltop people, these are Alexandrians.
Yeah, they're all blended.
So now it seems like, you know, just like Negan has his saviors, you're going to have this three-headed monster of Ezekiel, Rick, Maggie as almost one, even though they live in separate places.
Or, speaking of, you know, three-headed monsters, I don't know if you guys caught this line. Ezekiel says it to Morgan, and I know you guys caught it. I don't know if you took the significance to it like I did. He goes, "The saviors are a dragon with many heads and numbers legion." Well, who has many heads now?
Yeah. Right.
Exactly. So yeah. That's what I caught on to that. I was rewatching. I was like, okay. So, yeah, we got the three leaders, the many heads facing the many heads of the saviors, and it's something that's blatantly obvious, but for some reason I was immediately thinking Hydra from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and the Marvel comics.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, they're a multi-headed Hydra, mm-hmm. and two Hydras take out each other. There you go.
Right.
It's just, yeah, there's a lot of there's a lot of foreshadowing, and that's what makes, you know, great writing and good acting and good shows, you know, great dialogue. So, you know, you want to move on or we'll go to the next spot? Is there anything else we're really missing in between there before Negan arrives or?
Nothing but the quick observation that Morgan really doesn't want to fight, but he feels responsible for Ben, hence the wearing of his armor. So, you know, it's kind of like a double-edged sword.
He knew he had a fight. He knew he was going for a fight. He sharpened his staff.
He doesn't want to.
He knew he was going to fight, though. He knew he was going in.
He knew he was going to fight.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Initially, I think he was sharpening, you know, his bow for the walkers. I mean, it just turns out. I think so. I think it was more for the walkers.
To avenge Ben.
Until Ezekiel put this... whammy of a speech on him. Like he said, he was out there hunting walkers. Carol says, you know, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm going for, you know, I'll take out walkers." And she also said too, "You could fuck it up. You know, you could fuck this,
she thought he was attacking.
He was
going
to kill saviors." Yeah. Exactly.
I was going to say, let's move on. We've kind of put a lot of talking to that.
And Rick and them.
Yeah, so we're talking about when the Garbage Pail Kids arrive at Alexandria.
Before that, Dwight.
Oh yeah, okay, we gotta get.
Forget about our blonde-haired friend with a messed up face.
Yeah, we didn't have Dwight down our notes there.
Well, he delays Negan. We can put it that way. You know, obviously now Dwight is going to be somewhat trusted. They let him go. He says he'll delay what he can. He says that they're coming tomorrow. And he heads back. They let him go back to the sanctuary. But on his way back, he obviously fucking chops down some trees real quick. Some big ass trees,
how he did that.
The road.
You know, wait, before you get, don't get too far into that, because before he leaves, I want to talk a couple points about Dwight. One, we were all right in the fact that we said yes. Now he for this show, that's his the reason he makes the turn is because Sherry's now out from the clutches of Negan, and that was the only reason why he was there, and that's it. You know, so obviously, that's his motivation to turn. It's simple. Mm-hmm. We knew it. Everyone knew it. So I just wanted to mention that. Also, I thought bring up the point that no one else knew that place was called the Sanctuary, which was great. I'm glad they had that in there.
Rick, I loved Rick's reaction. Sanctuary.
Sanctuary. He's like, yeah, well, that's what we call it.
He's
thinking Terminus.
Wait, what?
I bet you he was thinking Terminus. You know?
Well, I mean...
similar to Terminus? You know, Sanctuary for All. Get it? No, just me? Okay.
Wait, but continue. Hey. No, wait, oh, wait, who was thinking Terminus? I'm confused.
Rick.
Nah, I don't know about that.
Maybe a flashback. I don't know. He hears Sanctuary and he thinks Terminus.
Well, yeah, I think. Yeah, I mean, he was. Yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, we don't get to be inside the character's head.
Yeah,
but yeah, exactly. He's probably he probably knew what he was talking about, but he was kind of like, as opposed to like, what's that? He was probably like, really? That was the tone I took it as. Like, really? He's calling it Sanctuary. The douchebag's calling it Sanctuary. He's like, yeah, that's what he's calling it. Anyway, yeah, so. You know, again, those are his motivations. How the fuck did he chop down all those trees?
Yeah.
Come on. Those, like you said, those were ginormous trees, and there were multiple men with axes and chainsaws clearing.
A winch and a truck can get you many places.
That's okay, right. But yeah, what, so. We never saw... The guy, wasn't the guy on a motorcycle, or he came in the truck? No, he took
a big freaking deuce and a half.
He pulled that big... Oh, he went with that big truck. Yeah, that's true. All right, I remember.
Or it might have been a Bronco. I don't remember.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't. It was. Yeah, dude. It was just a regular four wheel. It wasn't a fucking monster truck. But still, you're not.
It was an axe.
Whatever. I thought that was a little like I was a little much about that. But I mean, yeah. So I mean, look. There's not a lot to say about Dwight. I don't want to get into a big discussion about Dwight right now because you know what? They in my opinion, they underutilized Dwight this episode, and that's fine. They got a lot. They got these characters that, you know. You hope to be emotionally invested in. And even Dwight, they do real good work making bad guys into good guys.
Likeable. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know? Well, Dwight is the kind of guy that could have been on either side. And we know what kind of guy he was because when him and Sherry had the back and forth, she said, you're not the man that you used to be. And we know that he was a decent guy. We don't know exactly, you know what I mean? But in the end, he was doing this, like you said, Chris. He was doing this for a specific reason. It was to protect his wife, and they were protecting each other. His Dwight's big role is going to be next season.
Well, obviously. Absolutely, yes, absolutely.
And they gave us the scene with him finding that the their original house. When Sherry was on the loose and Negan was telling him to look for him, they gave us this breakdown of Dwight's story to kind of give him more humanity and gave us a reason for the viewers to like him in the future. And that's obvious that he'll be around. So it's just more ammunition for the viewers to kind of fall for another character and start to like him, even though he was from the bad, you know, from the sanctuary, from the bad group, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anybody else like get a hatred of Tara this episode?
Nah. This small one. Look, Tara, that's her character. That's who she is. Yeah. She's the impulsive, say what's on her mind thinking, and then also say the fucking obvious. That's what she does. That's what makes her character endearing and also annoying at the same exact time.
I didn't hate her, but during those tense moments with Dwight and them, they kill him.
Yeah.
And it's like glued to the screen. All right, I was invested in it. I was like, yeah, okay. Because let's be honest here, we've taken a day and now we've watched it again. There we go. We've rewatched it. This is our review. During my rewatch there, I couldn't take my eyes off the screen. I was like, yes, this is so good. And she goes, kill him. And I'm just like, would you just shut up?
Yeah.
I said it last night multiple times. Just shut up.
Yeah. Well, this is something
her, like anguish and all that.
You can feel her pain, but this is just a, you know, since we're talking about her quick, this is one of the questions that I wanted to ask you guys now. And after watching it myself again, we understand why Tara was upset and why she wanted Daryl to kill Dwight. She killed her, you know, he killed her lover she wants him dead. My thing is, there was a scene afterwards, after Daryl made the choice not to kill him, that Tara was sitting on the steps of the house, and she gave, you know, Daryl a look. Now, obviously, she's upset with him. what do you, you know, how do you think she's going to react with this? Do you think that Tara will be the one? Because we know that Daryl is the one that says, I don't care if this does work out. I don't care if he helps us. I'm going to kill that guy.
Yeah, I'm going to kill him anyway.
Do you think that, what do you think in the future and going forward, you think there could be a rift between Tara and Daryl? Do you think that Tara may go out on her own? Do you think Tara may try to kill him herself?
Let's be honest. I don't think Tara's going to last too long.
If she, either she's gonna be cannon fodder for later, or I mean, I can't believe she's lasted this long. They've used her as a device. I think her time is running out. The fact that they're making her an annoying nuisance now to be like saying things like that. I mean, you know what? I'm sorry. I don't really think she's that of an annoying nuisance. Although I don't think she's a needed character. Will she go out on her own? They're not gonna give her another fucking episode. They did that once. They're not gonna do it again. She's not an important enough character to do anything. They're not going to do anything
she
with her.
She can't hold her own episode.
She's a good character. Let's not get into that.
Yeah, she's a great actress. I didn't like her at first. I thought she was fucking annoying as hell. Mm-hmm. She grew on me, and I still can't believe she's been there since, what, season four? I still can't believe that.
Season four, yeah.
Right? It was season four.
It was season four with the governor's,
the governor's
episodes.
Okay. I can't believe that she's been there since season four, but.
God.
Whatever. The point is, to answer your question, man, no, they're not. They're, who cares? There's no rift. It doesn't matter. She's not important enough to do it. That's that. Let's not talk about Tara anymore.
On to the important stuff.
We're getting up in time here, and even though we're giving you a more in-depth discussion than we normally do, we do want to, you know, not make it 4 hours long, even though we can.
Oh, it could be.
Yeah. Negan shows up. Negan shows up. All right.
And
so,
before
you get there, I had started saying this before, but I want to just talk about the Garbage Pail Kids coming in. They rolled in three huge garbage trucks, which Mike
bicycles.
Made a good and bicycles, right? So you have very practical, like not that practical on this spectrum, and then not practical on the other spectrum. It's like, if they utilize those garbage trucks to their advantage in barriers and protection, fine, but. They didn't.
Have a shitload of gas.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
diesel.
So they show up, and Jadis is very demanding of everyone, and is like, you know, just there was something up. We all felt something weird.
It felt off.
Yeah, it just felt off. But so they're there. I just wanted to put that in there because obviously
I lay with him after.
Yeah, it's just very awkward and. Funny scene, but
I hate just a quick little note with the scavengers, the fucking caveman talk.
Yeah, the speech is
dude, we were like, what the fuck?
I know, we're like, we don't know what the fuck she's saying. What the hell?
She's down, like she's talking to a dog or something.
Right, yeah.
You know, very caveman,
very simplistic. Yeah,
it's too much. I can see them. The idea of where these writers are trying to go. Like, maybe let's revert a little bit. These people living in a dump. Let's revert back to early primitive attributes.
But why?
Oh, it's like a little monkey wrench.
Yeah,
in
but
the
it
game
isn't.
To make
but
it
isn't
make it
Mad
bit.
Max. That's a fucking bug in here.
Yeah, I know. It was too much.
It's too much. I don't like it. It's fucking.
And the bangs. She's that the one thing I wrote as a negative part when it comes to them is I would have liked her dead.
Yeah,
I feel like it would have been not that she's major, but since she is the leader of this group, it would have been nice for Simon to get clipped or someone. Let's see some. You know, we had basic. Run around half the time. You didn't even know who the fucking who was who.
Yeah. All right. Now you're getting a little ahead of yourself. So let's
but
pull it back.
Before that, I want you guys to notice something. Michonne's balcony there when she was setting up.
Mm-hmm.
Did you realize the garbage pail, whatever the name is? She was standing there, and she's like, "No, I'll go."
Yeah.
And she looks so much like Andrea.
That's what I heard that. I heard that.
I was like, it is kind of fitting because Michonne's taking Andrea's place.
Right. That was Andrea in the comic. That was Andrea up there.
I wanted to make up.
Let's not go.
So now on to Negan showing up.
Y'all going crazy. All right.
All right, Negan, so go ahead, Mikey. You were saying, go ahead. You started to say who's leading the fucking.
I wrote as far as who is on the flatbed with the bullhorn is the douchebag Eugene. I wrote fuck Eugene as one of the main notes here. And obviously points, when they show up, Rick asks, where is Negan? And the scumbag says, I'm Negan. And that gives the little nod to Rosita. To possibly, you know, to blow up the truck.
He was just like, you know what, just fucking do it. He's like, I'm
love
sorry.
The look on his face.
Yeah.
He started
tearing up, and he's like, fuck, fine, I guess this is real. It's like, this is happening. All right, blow the fucker up. Let's do it. Just fucking blow him up.
And obviously, that's when we see the double crossing of.
I loved how that wasn't drawn out. The double crossing, it wasn't drawn out at all.
Yeah, it was right away. You know,
no, so. but then he fucking stood there like a fucking moron, and you really gonna let her just hold a gun in your fucking face? Like, are you, as he's looking around watching his people get fucking slaughtered? Like, what the fuck is wrong with you?
Spark wasn't supposed to be lit right there. You know what I mean? If that would have just how it would have been a little odd if he would have attacked her or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
At specific
again,
moment.
Again, this so is why, and this is why my story. Sorry, my eyes. I got something in my eye. My story didn't get a 5, right? And I think you guys did the same, because it's these little elements. Like, yes, we get where they led, but because you wanted to go somewhere, I think you painted yourself into these little corners, and you kind of had to tiptoe out of them, and so you made these decisions. So you have Rick being undermined and held at gunpoint, and then gets shot.
Well,
I'm sorry, one second, right? But, you know, him getting shot is of no consequence. Absolutely none. There was literally no reason, because even the tension that you'd be like, oh, my God, he's shot. He did not. He at one point was he like, eh. And then he went about his merry way, filled with adrenaline, next to his son, killing people, fighting next to Morgan. So, fucking.
We kind of just forgot automatically.
And he's on. Right. Right.
And
so, you know, again, these little, like, oh, God. You know,
I know. So well, let's get to Negan, you know, unmasking the coffin. And at
before that, though, we're missing a key point there.
What?
Negan calls Rick's group animals.
Yeah.
Oh, because
don't you think that's a little priceless?
Yeah, of course it is. But again, this is something we talked about previously, and it's all perspective. It's all perspective. You think about it from Negan's group. Negan's group. All three of us are Negan. We're all Negan, right? So we're like, these motherfuckers, you know, they're, you know, we're over here trying to fucking provide and, you know, albeit military, but we're trying to provide some type of semblance of a society or whatever the fuck. And they all think that this is, I assume most of the people holding the guns with Negan are people that feel this way, right? And it's like, you know, so yeah, you're gonna look at these upstarts. It's the same thing with the fucking in Star Wars with the Empire. The Empire didn't think what they were doing was wrong. They just thought that that's the way that they should do things because people can't do it themselves. So if you're gonna be a piece of shit and lazy, then guess what? Yeah. You become a serf. You become this, and then the rebels form. And that's been that's not just fiction. That's what's happened in our human history, all throughout history. That's what happens. It's a matter of perspective. So. Yes, we are Rick's group. Three of us are Alexandrians, okay? We're not saviors. So, and you know, I'd be curious to see who watches the show that considers themselves a savior. Like, who's rooting for Negan? You know what I mean? Like, that's a fucking cool idea. Like, I don't think we've ever asked that on the show before. So I'm asking you guys out there, who's Negan out there? Are you Alexandrians or are you Negan? Or are you a fucking garbage belt kid? It's a, you know? Or are you a Hilltoppian?
Are you a loner?
Are you fucking...
I got a question for you. Yeah. All of you. Fans included. You ever hear the one about the stupid little prick named Rick?
God damn it. Who's finish it.
I didn't have a full quote.
Who got him and himself, who got him and all his friends killed? Dude, and
yeah,
I'm
who
so
thinks
glad.
He knew something or something, the other didn't know anything.
And
yeah,
got all his
stuff.
Friends killed. Yeah. Dude,
no, that was good.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up if one of you guys didn't. Dude, that was fucking great. He's so.
It was a great line.
He's so fucking great, man. You know? Yeah. Look, he may not have the look of Negan, but he's got the charisma, You know. In fact, yeah. He's more charismatic than the guy. What he lacks in F-bombs, he makes up in charisma. Let's put it that way.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, that was just great. You know, and again, the double cross turns out that the stupid bitch fucking, they cut the wire. We were so pissed. We were just like, fuck you. Fuck your face. Go to hell. You know?
But wait. Hey. We get Carl being the man, the legend, the myth.
I call that the patented Carl double tap. I want to name it that. All right?
Yeah.
Patented Carl double tap.
And then Daryl being all, I'm going to use a gun, grab a gun, use a gun, grab a gun.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Just fucking Call of Duty style, man. Or just like FPS, just run out of bullets, pick up another gun, man. That's what you do.
Oh, hey, your weapon? My weapon.
Yeah, that's what you do, man.
It was so good.
Yeah, there's some good stuff in there, man. There was some good stuff.
Really,
Mikey,
was.
What do you got, man?
Oh, no, I mean, I was just going to say, we were kind of going a little bit past, but obviously what before the fighting started, Sasha.
Oh, yeah, Sasha.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Did we touch on her already?
Yeah. We spent 15 minutes on her. But I mean, that whole thing was
coming out of the surprise to Negan.
Yeah, that was so great. That was actually really great. Yeah. Again, we all knew that was going to happen, obviously,
because his bargaining chip, you know, is now gone.
Let me ask you this. Let me pose this to you. Let me ask a question. Do you feel that fucking guy, all right, got what, you know, I mean, obviously he didn't get what he deserves. He deserves a fucking knife in the throat. But do you think that what he got, the fact that he was surprised multiple times now with a zombie, with a tiger, with two other groups, you know what I mean? Like, do you think that he got his just dessert? Like, he finally got what was part, the beginning of what's coming to him? I think they did it well.
His first strike.
I think he was like, what the fuck? What the fuck? What the fuck? Like, he was like,
He didn't know how to handle the fact that he's not number one. You know what I mean? That every little plan that he's ever had to really go out. I mean, listen, from what we know is he made his deals with the kingdom. He made his deals with the Hilltop, you know, forcefully, obviously, with the Hilltop. And he made his deals now with Rick. So everything that he's ever encountered or anybody that he's ever threatened for whatever, for weapons, for food, he's gotten it. So from what we know, this is the first time that he's ever dealt with like a loss in a way.
Yeah, hell yeah. Yeah. And I think they did it really well. I think that he got what the fuck was coming to him, and he got more than he obviously bit off more than he can chew. And, you know,
well, for a moment there, he thought he was still on top. You know, let's before everybody attacks, you know, we see Jadis bringing Rick to a second lineup. Yep. We see Negan having Carl. He said, I'm going to kill Carl. He's like, I like this kid. If I'm going to have a son, I'd like him to be just like this guy. Right. But I need to kill somebody that is number one to you. You know what I mean? Something that you'll
I'll
never
break your hands.
Yeah. Well, he said, I'll cut your hands off. He said, you can cut my hands off. And that's when we all agree that the conflict between Rick and Negan was fucking awesome. And Rick was just like, dude, and for the most part, I'll kill you. It doesn't matter how.
He says,
it doesn't have to happen today. It doesn't have to happen tomorrow. But I'm going to kill you.
He's like, you're already dead. And, like, that was the fucking clincher right up there.
Until,
like,
up until then, Negan thought everything was going to go his way until, storming from around the back, we see Ezekiel and we see Shiva pouncing on one of the saviors.
I thought it was Simon. I was pissed that it wasn't.
Me too. That's what I said too. I said it would have been cool to see one of the major guys like that.
No, Simon. No, they got to save Simon and they got to save Jadis for next season because those are going to be mini battles. Those are mini bosses. All right. So that's what's going to happen next season.
You know, Ezekiel's, you know, coming in, and Alexandria won't fall today. You know,
Alexandria will not fall this day.
Not on this day. It was just awesome. That's when we were all like, fuck yeah.
We were like, yeah. If you look at the live reaction, all you hear from us is, yeah, fuck yeah, motherfucker, yeah, put him in a body bag, yeah. You know, we were just all, I just left it all in. I was like, it's fucking great.
Yeah, it was finally, you know, it was a part of the season that was just overjoyed for us, and I don't think any of us really showed that much emotion. Maybe the time before this episode was maybe when we saw Daryl come around after he escaped.
Yes.
And we saw that Rick and Daryl embrace, like, my brother is back kind of a thing. I don't think we've ever got that animated, you know, in one of these episodes.
Yeah.
You know, my biggest thing was, because, you know, listen, we've done this whole season and this second half season with you guys on our channel, and you've seen a lot of ridicule with our reviews, and you've seen a couple, you know, a lot of ups and downs, like Chris said earlier, how we just gauged these episodes. I see it's almost like I don't want this show to turn into all you have to see is the first, the middle, and the end.
In the end, yeah.
I mean, we got the cliffhanger last year, which got a lot of ridicule too, because a lot of people said that they should have taken Glenn and Abraham out in that finale and not have us wait and drag out this whole the whole 7 months prior until the show came back in October. We saw from this premiere of season 7, you know, is who finally got it, which was a great episode. I mean, in the end, and when we all saw that, we were all like, oh my God, this is crazy. And I think it kind of made up for the time that we waited and all the ridicule.
I think it definitely.
I don't want it to turn out to have filler, you know, mid-season premiere, mid-season finale, great. Finale, great. You know what I mean? I want them to, and I think this will change because obviously now we're at war, and in the end, Negan says, and we see Negan after he leaves Alexandria, we see Negan standing in front of all his people and saying, we're going to war. You know what I mean? And it was very cool to see, especially after everybody leaves for the Alexandrians and the Hilltop, like I mentioned earlier, how now they seemed like one unit. And it was nice to see each leader speaking. You know what I mean? We saw Maggie speaking to everybody, to the group. We see Ezekiel and we see Rick speaking. And we see, of course, Shiva laying right there on the ground, all cool with the rest.
Wait a second. Before we get to that, I know we kind of keep going forward and back and forward and back. But, I mean, I still have a couple more things to say about before we get to the end. I think Jesse might, too.
We skipped over a pretty big part, right?
Yeah, we did. We Jesse was cutting out a little bit there. We still have an internet issue. Sorry, guys. But so Jesse, we'll get to that in a second. What I wanted to say is I just wanted to mention, you know, Negan, how he just takes everything in stride. So he's the Joker. Think about the Joker. The Joker's just a sadistic maniac, right? And he's just constantly laughing at it. He's constantly got that smile on his face. And every so often, it'll crack. That facade will crack. And that's what happened to Negan when Rick was in his face. And he's like, you're already dead. You just don't know it. Like, you're all dead already. And then he cracked a little. And then he went back. And he's just like, because that's how he is. That's how he deals with it. So even when he's like, they got a damn tiger. He's like, Simon, you taste that? That's shit. We're eating shit right now. You know, like, that's his response. I thought that was fantastic. I loved it because it showed like he wasn't like, God, he didn't make stupid mistakes because he was angry. He just got back on his horse, so to speak, and put his finger up and they left. You know, that was also kind of bullshit that nobody, that 10 guns shooting at the truck. That truck's not bulletproof. That was a canvas truck, wasn't it? Or am I wrong?
Well, there must be like a solid bed behind them.
But still.
I know, I was saying it. He said it was arm just exposed.
I know. So anyway, the point is that I just wanted to make sure that somebody said that because that was a really fun part. Jesse, what else have we got?
We skipped over the whole Michonne Tower scene.
There you go. I was.
So it did real justice to the Andrea comic scene in which a guy comes up in the tower, starts beating up Andrea, and somebody falls from the tower. All right, we don't have the tower anymore. Tower's gone completely. So we get a balcony scene. Michonne's fighting this Andrea lookalike. And
that lady was a brute.
She reminded me of freaking Drogo from
from
Rocky.
Yeah, she definitely, yeah.
Four. I was like, Christ. the thing is, when the person fell, we didn't know who it was. Like, yeah. We knew, but we didn't know.
Yeah.
When they fell, Rick, he was saddened. but then he was angry. Yeah. And then he delivered that line. He was like, you know what? It's over. You're dead. You're already dead. I don't care.
Yeah.
I'm dead. You're dead. We're all dead.
Well, I don't think the world thought that it was her. It was Michonne. You know what I mean?
Well, no.
It's just for them to build up such an episode for Sasha. They're not going to let one of the best characters on the show just die.
Yeah, off
camera.
Yeah.
And you know, so it was, you know, it was an element. It was, that wasn't for us. That was, like you said, Jesse, that was for Rick to think.
Yeah,
for himself
and for non-comic readers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we also got good lines like "The widow is alive, guns a-blazing," and we get to see Gabriel using a gun. I mean,
yeah.
Gabriel using a gun, Morgan killing people again.
Yeah, Rick notices it, and he's like, "Okay, yeah."
Yeah, he's like, "Cool." Well, I mean, we got a lot. You know, we're going to be wrapping this up real quick because the ending is real good, and I'll get back to what Mike was saying. But, you know, we got a lot of gunfire. We got a lot of G.I. Joe / Stormtrooper firing where they're just literally just firing into nothing. People did die. The garbage people decide, you know, they have their own little plan going on. Okay, before we leave, though, right before when she brings Rick down, okay, she talks to Negan and she's like, we said 12, and he's like 10. And I'm sitting there going, hold on a minute. So this motherfucker, it hasn't been fucking extorting fucking the junk people, but he has everyone else. Like, what the fuck is that about? Who the fuck are these people that they get to get out from underneath his rule?
They approached him. That's the difference.
Probably. It's probably something like that.
But that doesn't matter. Okay, but you're missing the point. This is fucking Negan. When has Negan, that we know of in this show, ever been like, oh yeah, sure, we'll work with you? No, that's not what he does. He takes. So you're saying that he allowed that to be. So they came to him and said, "We have information for you, but we're not gonna unless we make this deal." And 12 what? Guns?
People.
People.
He said people.
Okay, so they were people.
People are a resource.
So they took people for their scavenging. It just pissed me the fuck off, and I'm not gonna talk any more about it unless you guys want to say something else. It pissed me the fuck off. Good on them.
Something that ticked me off. Enid was there. Who was looking after Judith?
Exactly. Where the fuck was Judith? Who was left at the hilltop? Obviously, someone's left at the hilltop, but...
Of course, the elderly are left. But I don't trust anyone, just anyone, to look after Judith. Who is looking after Judith?
Yeah, well, you kind of have to at this point, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Unless they brought her along and they threw her in the house.
Oh, you didn't see the baby Bjorn that she had on her back? You didn't see that?
Yeah.
Judith was at it. She had a Judith had a fucking .22 in her hand, man.
Yeah.
She had a .22 revolver. She's like...
Yeah.
Gave her a cap gun.
So we're here at the end now. We've talked about the fighting and all that.
Yeah.
Maggie's like her commentary talking with Rick about I forget exactly everything she said. But
she talked about from the beginning. She explained she's talking to Sasha and obviously that was a scene before Sasha left. She knew Maggie already knew.
You think she killed herself or something like that? And Maggie was like, I think she did. And then she says something about, we mean everything to each other, and we were meant to since the beginning, before any of this even started.
Yeah.
And that got me so bad.
Yeah, hell yeah.
That was so good.
You know, wait, before we continue with that, Negan and Eugene's fucking poker face.
Yeah.
When he fucking asks him, he's like, how'd that happen? He's like, and he flat out with no qualm was like, nope, she must have ran out of air, bro. Sorry.
Well, we'll see. I would have liked him to turn around and just blast.
Think he's going to, Negan's not dumb. He's going to either, like you said in the live.
You may know already.
He's going to find the plastic bag or, you know, that's not over with. But I didn't want us to, not talk about it on this discussion. Yeah. So, all right, so we're back at the end. Jesse, I agree, man. Like that, even when Morgan and Carol sitting on the step, like I said in the live react, like I was sad. I just felt really sad. Like I was happy that all happened. I was happy they all came together. I was very elated. You know, the three of us really put our emotions into the show, which is obviously why we're doing a fucking YouTube channel about it. You know what I'm saying? But
yeah,
and it's fun. It's just fun because like, how often do you get to experience those things in life? You know, so we obviously have to do it vicariously through. But you know what? It's the same. It's the same endorphins. It's the same feeling as if you did it yourself. It's the same. There's no different. there's no different good feeling for someone else doing something good than you in partaking in it, or you doing, it's the same thing. It's the same exact feeling. It's the same chemical. So my point is that, yeah, dude, I felt sad. I still feel sad when I think about it. I think back to the beginning of the season, you know, when all that went down, and I think about when everyone died, and it's just like, and it's really fucking sad. It's sad that everyone has to go through what they're going through, and it's just like, you know.
But you know what should cheer you up?
What's that?
At the end there, when she's holding the watch, mm-hmm. and you can't hear what she says, but you can read her lips, and she says, "Let's start a new beginning for all of us."
Yeah.
Yeah. That should cheer everyone up right there.
Well, that was great. Again, yeah. it was a very somber, you're right, but even then I was still like, oh God, you know, like choking up. But yeah, but that was actually pretty great.
Yeah.
You know, they don't really do those moments, do they?
Not often.
That moment at the end. Right, guys? I mean, that they don't really do that moment. That is like that's an epic moment there.
Well, we haven't seen anything really positive in a long time.
Well, besides just positive, but that strong, like that whole thing where, and that's why, you know, I used I think it was for discussion, I'm using Maggie for the thumbnail. I think I am. In that scene, because she's that whole thing, like that's like a movie, like that was like a movie ending, mm-hmm. where they wrap everything up like that. Like, it to me, it was one of the best finales. I'm not gonna lie, the ending was like one of the best finales, ending of a finale that you could have.
Oh yeah.
You know, especially for this show, like, again, it was poignant. It was that whole explanation. I don't know, man. They did, and the more I think about it, the more, you know, the more sad I get, but also the more happy I get, and the more, you know, I enjoyed it. I just really fucking enjoyed it. Now, and the more I think about it, I'm gonna go back and watch it again, because I just want to feel that again. I want to feel that joy when Shiva takes that guy out and all hell breaks loose. And
absolutely.
And they're all just like, they all just, it's just really, especially for this group of people, because, you know what? Listen, let's be honest with ourselves and everyone here, okay? They did this on purpose. They knew what the fuck they were doing. They were like, just the same way that they said, let's set up this premiere so we find out who dies, let's set up the ending so that by the time we get there, people need this win so bad it'll make it that much better. So what'd they do? They dragged shit out. They made what seemed like dumb decisions. They made them beat down really badly. You know, they like really beat everybody down. You know, until at the end, everybody gets that win, you know. Yep. So they did that. They did it good. I fell for it. I think we all fell for it. It worked.
I enjoyed it. You know? I enjoyed it 100%.
So, you know, you know, you know what? There was one thing I just wanted to ask you guys. I mean, let's finish it. Are we finished with this section? Do you have anything else you want to add about the finale and how it made you feel, and that I know we all hung up on the Skype call and we cried to ourselves to sleep, and that's fine. Yeah. That's fine.
I think Mike said he
Mike,
had one
Mike,
question.
Mike watched it afterwards and he sat there tearing and crying. I get it. It's cool.
No, well, the question, like I said, was the whole Tara thing with Daryl, but I enjoyed it. I won't necessarily say that it was one of my favorite finales. I mean, I do like some of the original first, second, third season. Some parts of me, I mean, I could say it was a little unsatisfying, because, like I told you, I would have liked to see maybe Simon go or Jadis go, or but in the end, I'm not going to be nitpicky about everything. I'm glad to see our group as a whole, you know,
bigger than before. Now they're finally together. And everyone,
Not even that. It's just they finally gave a shot to Negan.
Yeah.
It's like Rocky, you know, or something, you know, where he's getting beaten and beaten and beaten and beaten and beaten, and he doesn't even get a throw in, you know, a punch in. And finally they gave us a round.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So and that's what this is going to be. This is going to be a super fight, and round 1 of the war, you know, we'll go to the Alexandrians and the Hilltop and everybody for right now. So let's see where it goes. You know, let's see where the season takes us. And I'm sure it's going to be action packed. And, you know, it is sad that we're not going to have the show around for the next 6-7 months. But
We got plenty of filler, man.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. We got plenty to do. We got plenty to do for you guys. So I think that's really, I think it's time to wrap it up, guys. I think we've exhausted what we said. I'm sure there's going to be more shit that we're going to want to say later. So we'll make a whole nother hour video for you guys. No, I'm kidding. But anyway, again, thank you everyone for watching this and sticking with us for the season and, you know, giving your comments and your suggestions and everything like that. It's been quite a ride for The Walking Dead. This was our first season doing The Walking Dead here on Third Person, and we can't wait to do the next one. So guys, go ahead and if you want to leave us any comments, obviously leave in the section. If you want to get to us on social media, you want to leave us anything on there, it's at Third Person Pod on all of those things. Don't forget, we still have that promo code going with our buddies at comicblitz.com. Get yourself 3 months of comics for only $3. For $1 a month, you get yourself unlimited comics for the first 3 months. Use promo code Third Person Pod. And if you haven't checked out the live reaction or the review for this episode for the season finale, go and check those out. Those are cool. And again, it's the last one for this season. So, you know, kind of sad. But we got a lot of things coming. We're adding some more shows to our repertoire. And yeah, it's going to be an exciting summer. So we're gonna get into a lot of good stuff. Anything else, guys? Any signing off with The Walking Dead? Any very last comment that you want to say about The Walking Dead? You love it. Great. All right. Yeah. Guys, we're going to see you on the next discussion for our next episode of something. All right. That's it.
Badlands for sure.
No, we got Badlands. We got a lot of stuff coming on. Guys, thank you so much. We'll see you in the comments. See you later.